Ladies and gentlemen, the factory for Boston is open.
What is going on, you guys? It is Jesse Almeida here, live on YouTube and here on Beantown Takes. And today, we're going to do a little bit of a reaction video. Who's to blame for this Red Sox start? Now, obviously, as you guys know, the Red Sox have not met the requirements that I predicted them for this season recently. Right now, they are 23-26. They are below 500, and they are also in fourth place. Especially after a season last year, I did not predict the Red Sox to be this mediocre, and that's what they are right now. They're mediocre. They're flirting with 500 with the 500 win percentage, and they're losing to teams that they shouldn't be losing. Like last night, as I'm recording this, the Red Sox just lost 10-0 to Baltimore. That should not be happening. We should be taking 4 or 5 at least, well, 3 or 5 at least, if not sweep them. Right now, Tampa Bay is ahead of us. I don't know how Tampa Bay is always good, even when they're subtracting many players. I don't understand it, but they're ahead of us. They've exceeded expectations so far. The Blue Jays are ahead of us as expected. The Yankees are killing it this season, and we're blowing it this season. And also, and with this slow start too, it also brings up questions of like what's to come in the future for the Red Sox. And I personally think the blame goes to the owner staff because they constructed a roster that just doesn't work. They don't have a solid number three pitcher right now. They don't have good bullpen, and they don't address it for some weird reason. They never address their bullpen, and they went out and got Trevor Story, right? Who you realistically do not need. Yeah, his bat is valuable, but you did not need to sign a shortstop. And that's what he is. He's a shortstop. You move him to second base, great. But is he committed to being a second baseman for the future? If he is, then that's a good signing. If he's not, that could potentially push Bogarts out the door. And that could really hurt you in the long run. Because if Bogarts leaves, that could mean Devers leaves. So, like, there's a lot of question marks going forward. So, let's see what this guy has to say about who is to blame for the Red Sox start.
What is going on, everybody? Welcome back to Red Seat Radio. My name is Corbin, and we see this a lot. When teams aren't doing well, fans get frustrated, and they want to know who to blame. So blame starts getting thrown around to just about everybody, and that is what's happening currently to this Boston Red Sox team. I'm seeing it on my comments. I'm seeing it on Twitter. I'm seeing it on Reddit, where people are trying to blame someone for this Red Sox bad start. So what we're going to do today is we're going to go through everyone that is being blamed right now. We're going to talk about why they're being blamed. We're going to talk about whether or not I think that there should be blame on these guys. And at the end of it all, I want you guys to tell me who you think is to blame for this Red Sox crappy start. But before I get into that, do me a favor. Make sure you guys have hit that subscribe button if you haven't already. If you're new here, we talk Red Sox content almost every single day. Also, make sure you guys are hitting these like buttons as well. If you are newly subscribed or currently subscribed, it is the best way to help this channel out. And it would mean a lot to me. Thank you all very much for clicking on this one. Let's get into it. This is Editing Corbin here, and I totally forgot to mention that I will once again be live tomorrow night, probably around 7:15 because the game's a little bit later, but we are going to be watching the Atlanta Braves-Boston Red Sox game together tomorrow night, 7 p.m. It was a ton of fun the last couple of times, so make sure you guys are stopping on by. All right, sorry about that. Let's get into it. So what I did is I picked out the top three groups or people that have had the most blame on them so far this year, and we're going to start at the top with the GM, the face of this franchise, the guy who was supposed to put together a team that could win a World Series, Chaim Bloom. Now, Chaim Bloom has been getting, in my opinion, most of the heat for this tough start, and it's mostly because simply people think Chaim Bloom has not done enough. We lost a lot of good pieces in the offseason. People believe that the pieces that Chaim Bloom picked up and put together to try and fill those voids isn't working out. It wasn't the right guys. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a look at what pieces Chaim Bloom brought in and where the blame of this terrible start is on Chaim Bloom. And we're going to start with the offense, because over this offseason, we lost Renfro and we lose Schwarber. Two guys who are offensive.
And realistically, you could have kept both of those guys. Why they traded Renfro for two prospects just to take on JBJ's terrible contract is beyond me. Again, Hunter Renfro is a 30 home run guy almost every single year. And he drives in at least 80 RBIs a year. And will not bat under 250. Why do you get rid of a guy like that? I just don't understand that. Why do you get rid of a guy like that? I mean, if you want to argue that Schwarber, that they should have moved on from Schwarber, I guess I can kind of, I think they should have kept Schwarber, but if you want to have Schwarber, like, saying, oh, they could have let him go, that's all right, fine. Because they were doing good without Schwarber at the beginning of the season. So if you want to argue that losing Schwarber was not a big issue, all right, we can have that debate, but there's no way you should have lost both of them. And especially for Jackie Bradley Jr., who is statistically the worst hitter in baseball. I mean, he's doing all right this year. He's batting .227, but he only has one home run. I think he's driven in at 16 RBIs. He's batting, did I mention he's batting .227? I think I did. And he's got like 13 doubles or whatever it is. Not the production that Hunter Renfro was giving you at all. Not at all.
Powerhouses in this lineup. Now, in my opinion, Heim Bloom brought in Trevor Story, who was supposed to be the power hitter that Hunter Renfro was, while also providing a lot of on-base percentage that Kyle Schwarber gave. Kyle Schwarber, yes, he was a power hitter, but at the end of the day, he is most notably known for being able to be selective with pitches and get on base a lot. And Trevor Story was a similar player in Coors. Add on the 30-40 home run capabilities, and you've got a guy who could possibly fill those voids. As for the other pieces that Heim Bloom added, this is where you can start to blame Heim for this. Heim Bloom had a roster construction where Travis Shaw and Jonathan Araúz were your bench players. Travis Shaw ended up going 20 before he was DFA'd. Araúz couldn't hit anything. He was swinging all over the place, and now he's in the minor leagues trying to rehab from COVID. If you had begun the year with more depth on this bench, if you had begun the year with guys who could genuinely be an X factor coming out in late games, then maybe you're in a different situation, but also maybe not. Right? Maybe not. That's something that you can look at 2020 hindsight. Maybe if you had Cordero and Duran, or Duran Casas, something along those lines, Duran and Downs, something like that on this bench. Maybe it's a different story, but again, maybe it's not. In my opinion, I think Heim Bloom constructed an offense that could and should be hitting the crap out of baseballs. It just simply isn't right now. As for the other side of the ball in the bullpen, this is where he's catching the most heat, and it's kind of rightfully so. He had all the opportunities this postseason to get a dominant closer in this pen, and he simply didn't. Yep. But there might be a reason behind that. So let's talk about it. Heim Bloom this offseason added Rich Hill, Michael Wacha, Matt Strom, and Jake Diekman. Now, Strom and Diekman are fully bullpen pieces. Obviously, Matt Strom has worked out really, really well. Diekman, another story. But what I want to talk about are Rich Hill and Michael Wacha. And the reason I want to talk about them is because, in my opinion, and I think what Heim Bloom was trying to do, was to have either Hill or Wacha in the pen as well. On top of that, the plan going into the season was to have Whitlock and Houck in that pen on top of either Wacha or Hill. And Wacha.
And right now, Whitlock is starting. Why is Whitlock a starting pitcher? I have no idea why Whitlock is a starting pitcher. That's on Alex Cora. Whitlock is a dominant piece out of the bullpen, and you move him to the starting rotation, that's ridiculous. You know who the Red Sox did that one time before, and it was catastrophically bad. You know who that guy was? Daniel Bard. That didn't work either. I don't know why you screw somebody up like that. I just don't know why.
and Hill have been doing extremely well as a starter this year, but imagine a bullpen where you have the options of either Rich Hill, Mike Wacha, and Whitlock and Houck. That is an insanely deep bullpen. That is a versatile bullpen. That is a flexible bullpen. And whether or not you have a closer or not, those are all guys who can get you out in late innings, because a lot of those guys, Whitlock, Houck, they're young, but they don't give a damn what situation they're in. They're going to throw the ball like they've always thrown the ball, and that is a great trait to have as a relief pitcher in this league. The problem comes with Chris Sale's injury. Obviously, you can't plan for Chris Sale to be out for half of the season, and now you have to have Wacha or Hill in that rotation, along with either Whitlock or Houck. And that is where you are killing your bullpen. You are taking away a ton of flexibility, a ton of versatility, and you're relying on guys you shouldn't be relying on. Matt Barnes, Sawamura, Robles in the ninth inning, as opposed to either Whitlock, Houck, Wacha, or Hill. Could Heim Bloom have gone out and gotten a reliever, a starting pitcher, after Chris Sale gets injured? 100%, and this is where I am blaming Heim Bloom for this bad start. He could have and should have been more reactive to Chris Sale's injury. Even if you pick up a guy who is maybe a quadruple A player, a guy who spent most of his time in the AAA but also has experience in the big leagues, to fill in either a rotation spot or a bullpen spot to at least try and bolster the fact that your star pitcher is once again on this IL.
Right.
However, at the end of the day, Heim Bloom's plan for his bullpen and rotation seems solid to me. Going in, you're adding three pieces that Houck and Whitlock are your two most young, talented pitchers. Hill and Wacha are both experienced and pretty good out of the pen. We've seen what they can do with the starting rotation. Imagine that coming out of the bullpen in the seventh and the sixth. It makes a lot of sense. Unfortunately, it didn't work out, and he should have been more reactive. But do I think all of the blame for this terrible start is on Heim Bloom? No. So let's get into some of the other guys that have been mentioned as well. So we start with the front office. Let's move on down to the manager of this team. Alex Cora has been getting a lot of heat for this bad start, and the main reason why is because people simply think that he is over managing. He's using guys based on statistics, and
I 1000% agree with this statement, and the reasoning for that is just because of how the game is played nowadays. For example, right now Nathan Eovaldi is your ace, right? He's had a pretty decent season. How come the maximum amount of innings he goes is five most of the time? I don't understand how starting pitchers can't go past five innings anymore. I don't understand it. Before, back in the day, we would see starting pitchers go at least 7 innings, 6.5, at least. Nowadays, it's rare to see somebody go past 6 innings. It's rare to see them go 6 period. Especially, even if they're pitching good, they'll take them out after 5 innings or whatever. Why? Why? Because the analytics say batters are better at facing a pitcher their third time up. Who cares? Who cares if a pitcher is good? Leave him in. Why go to your bullpen early? Your bullpen's one of the weakest links on your team. Why? Why? It's hard to watch baseball anymore. It really is, because that's one of the biggest reasons too, is so many pitchers coming into a game or whatever. It's not that complicated. It isn't. If a pitcher is dominating, leave him in there. When you get first sign of trouble, that is when you pull him.
Based on matchups as opposed to gut feelings and whether or not they're performing. Again, right. When you guys talk about Heim Bloom, bad start. And the main reason why is because people simply think that he is over managing. He's using guys based on statistics and based on matchups as opposed to gut feelings and whether or not they're performing. When you guys talk about Heim Bloom, I agree. I agree with the fact that Alex Cora is over managing right now. But in my opinion, he's over managing not because he wants to, but out of necessity. Think about it this
and
way.
That's because of the front
if
office.
You had bottom of the eighth, you have a runner on second and third, you have Bobby Dalbec at the plate against a right-handed hitter, are you trusting him in that situation? Probably not. You have the top of the eighth inning. You've got a runner on first. You've got Sawamura on the bump. He needs to get two more outs. He's facing a lefty that smashes righties and a righty that is a powerhouse hitter. You're 3-4 hitters of the other team. Are you trusting him to get those last two outs? Probably not. What about Robles? Probably not. Right? Those are guys that you should be relying on that just simply aren't performing right now. And so in my opinion, Alex Cora is not overmanaging because he wants to only play the statistics. He wants to be the hero of this team. That's simply just not the case. Alex Cora is at his best when he is playing gut feelings and he is doing things that he thinks that will put this team in a better position to win. But unfortunately, due to the performance of his players, he has to sort of do this statistical sort of way of managing, because that's your only option right now. So in my opinion, the blame will not and should not fall on Alex Cora. The last group I want to talk about is finally the players on the field, the guys actually putting in the work every single day. And if you want to blame somebody for this Red Sox bad start, this is who you should blame. Whether or not Heim created and crafted a good enough, deep enough bullpen, a good enough, deep enough lineup has nothing to do with this anymore. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter who Heim Bloom is putting on this team. It doesn't matter who Alex Cora is swapping in late game. If no one on this team can produce the way that they are supposed to produce,
really
imagine a lineup
right
where Kike Hernandez hitting 250, Trevor Story is hitting 260, Alex Verdugo is hitting almost 300. Now it's a completely different story. No blame's getting thrown around, and we're talking about whether or not this team should be in first place.
And
if you are going to blame anyone, in my opinion, you are blaming the guys who cannot hit over 200 right now. You are blaming guys who are striking out or popping out on the first pitch in big situations. You are supposed to blame the guys who are coming into these late games and can't seem to throw a single strike. That is who the blame should be on here. While you can blame Heim Bloom for his poor reactive skills to an injury that derailed a pretty decent plan, at the end of the day, it is the guys on the field, in my opinion. Let me know in the comment section down below what you think of my aunt.
See, I kind of disagree with that last statement, because there are some players who are playing to their capability, and then there are players who are not playing at their capability. Yes, it does come down to the players at the end of the day, but at the same time, you could say that there are some players who are doing their end. Even though there are a bunch of players who are not doing their end. So it's kind of hard to put the players together as a whole for the blame. You could pick out players, however, that are not performing as well. Like Kike Hernandez is not having a good season this year. Jackie Bradley Jr. needed to turn around his career, and he hasn't really done that for the most part. Another player that you could really blame is Bobby Dalbec. Bobby Dalbec was supposed to be your first baseman, your full-time first baseman to produce power and all that. He hasn't really been good at the dish. And at the same time, he has not been good defensively. So it's hard to pinpoint the players as a whole. You got to look at the players who should be having decent seasons, or fair seasons at least. And they are just completely underachieving. Like, you can't blame Bogarts. You can't blame JD. You can't blame Rafael Devers. You can't blame Nathan Eovaldi. I mean, there are some players that you cannot put in that category of blame. So, that's kind of where I end with this. There's not going to be many Sox games for me this season, because obviously you guys know I'm going to an NBA final game coming soon. Again, you guys are are probably okay with that, honestly. And this team needs to turn it around sooner rather than later. Leave a like if you guys enjoyed. Subscribe right now if you guys are new. You guys know what to do. Go check out my website. The link is in the description down below. I have a new article as well from the Boston Bruins, so go check that out. My Venmo account's in the description as well if you guys want to donate to go to games, so on and so forth. Anything helps. Appreciate all the love and support, guys. It's been Jesse, and I'll see you guys in the next video.